Franco Moretti from the Stanford Literary Lab, and I will talk about a project we have on canon and archive in the 19th century British novel. It's in part a sociological project, it's in part a morphological project, and I will present a series of findings, some expected, some surprising, some explainable, some unexplainable, and I hope it will be interesting.
This is typical project of what we do at Stanford, a group project. Mark Algie Hewitt is a young, very young professor of English and Digital Humanities. Sarah Allison and Melissa Denmark were students at Stanford and are now in New Orleans and Frankfurt. Ryan Heuser and Anna Walser are both graduate students at Stanford. Ryan and Mark are the programmers for this study. And it's a study that begins with a question, which is actually a rather self-critical question about the digital humanities, which runs something like this. It's a new field, it doesn't produce so many novelties, etc., etc. The main novelty, and the one that's gonna last, clearly is the size of the archives. We used to be able to study a few hundred novels, say. Now we can study thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. It's like having been given a telescope. It used to be able to see a certain number of stars, now you can see galaxies and galaxies. Whence the great euphoria in the field? We're no longer bound by a small canon, we're no longer blinded by a small canon. It's a moment of great euphoria, it's also the moment of truth. Yes, we can see many more things than we used to be able to see. Do all these new stars that we have seen change the way in which we think about literary history and literary theory, or not? Because if they don't change the way in which you look at literary history and theory, knowledge is always a good thing, but you know, it's not significant. This is not a rhetorical question. My answer will not be, oh yes, they do change it. It's much more, again, doubtful than that. It's not a rhetorical question because digital humanities is really the current form of the digital age of quantitative historiography. Quantitative historiography is something that was basically created in this city. And in a famous speech, then essay on the long way, Fernando Leo, the essay in which he greets the advent of a quantitative history that will change, that will make a break with the traditional form of 19th century history, Rovell specified as the typical objects of this new quantitative history demographic progressions, the movement of wages, the variation in interest rates, productivity, money supply, money demand. Now, demographic progressions and all these other things clearly are quantifiable objects. But the reason that could bring about a break with traditional historiography are only in part to do with the fact that they were quantified. The point was they were completely new objects for historiography compared to military, diplomatic, legislative history. That was the novelty. Quantitative series strengthened the novelty but did not create it. In our case, we used to be able to study 200 novels, now we can study 200,000, but there's the novels. There is no new object. Unlike old quantitative history, digital humanities has not introduced a new object in the study. So where is the novelty? Usually the answer is, oh, you will certainly find the novelty in those 199,000, etc., etc., novels that no one has really read or reread since they were published. But, okay, obviously, one sees the argument, how could How could there not be something new there? But another reflection a few years after Brodel, this time is an anthropologist, Le Roi Durand, we know more about people exchanging goods for reasons of prestige than about the kinds of exchanges that go on every day. More about ritual observances than ordinary services. More about the circulation of dowry money than about selling vegetables. Dowry money, the money given for marriage and vegetables, is really the perfect antithesis, because they're both obviously important forms that money takes, but for completely opposite reasons. Dowry money is important because it happens once in a lifetime. Selling vegetables because it happens every day. So it's really, you know, and again, there is an echo of quantities. Okay, let's take this antithesis, which is so clear, move it to the history of literature. Year 1814, England, historical novels. Two novels are published, 100 novels are published, two of those 100 novels. One is called Waverley by Walter Scott, and the other one is called Sir Ferdinand of England. Also a historical novel by a certain James Brewer. At first sight, you see these two novels, it seems obvious. Walter Scott Waverley is dowry money, and Sir Ferdinand of England is vegetables. But actually, when you look at the historical record, this is really not so, because Waverley was both the immediately prestigious text, the text that according to some, changes the history of the European novel, or at least about which that can be said and argued. On the other hand, it was also the enormously popular book that everybody read. It was both dowry money and vegetables. But if Waverley was that, then what does Sir Ferdinand of England add that we did not already have in Waverley? What do we learn from this forgotten book and from the thousands of other forgotten books of the time? Knowledge, you know, knowing more is always good, but, you know, this knowledge actually teaches something different. Let me give you a final example about this. This, sorry, incidentally, is the plan for today. I will return to it in a moment. It's going to be in three parts. The first is the sociological part. Second and third are have to do with literary morphology, even though in a slightly unusual way. I thought I had inserted certain charts, which I had not inserted, so I will not insist on that point. Let me say, let me sort of go back to the plan as a whole. We started the study as a study of canon and archive. Because, not because we wanted necessarily to prove why the canon was better than the archive, but because we wanted to figure out what does the archive teach us that knowing the canon had not already told us. And so it was, it should be archive canon in order of importance, because that's the new thing, the archive. What do we mean by these two terms? Archive is what has been preserved, now digitally preserved mostly, of all that has been published. The novelty of the digital situation is that the books preserved, and the books, the smaller set of books, the corpus that you use for a research, they're coming closer and closer to the number of published books. For contemporary books, there is no difference between the published and the archived, because everything is already in digital. For the past, it's not so so clear, obviously, but already in the 19th century, we are getting close to something like that. What about canon? Thinking about the canon, we started by taking a shortcut, which you will see in the course of my presentation. There is a small database of 19th century novels. Like many people in digital humanities, we work in the 19th century because it's free from copyright, and it's also free from earlier print, which creates difficulties to the computer in recognizing it. So, there is a small, very well curated corpus of 250 novels in England in the 19th century means more or less 1% of the novels published in the course of the century. That seemed the right order of magnitude for the canon. We started by using this, let's call it Chadwick reading practice. But then, as we were thinking about it, we said, well, but why rely entirely on the choices of people? We don't even know who chose these 250 novels. And then the database had its own problems. So we started thinking, how can one measure? And in thinking about this, we came, I returned to one chart which has been very important for my thinking about the sociology of literature. Many of you know it, it's one of the versions, this is a Fuller's version of Gautier's diagram of the French literary field around in the third quarter of the 19th century, more or less. Now, in a sense, there is something intuitively that this cannot be right, because it's too ordered. No distribution is so fantastic. There, every little box in the chart is occupied. And there are a few arrows that complicate matters, but it's even unlike the empirical charts that Bourdieu makes in distinction in the books that distinction are very different. And the principle, for those who don't know it, is this. This is the axis of prestige. This is the axis of success. We call them prestige and popularity, let's say. This means high prestige, but very little popularity. High popularity, very little prestige. High on both counts, and low on both counts. I said this cannot be right. I don't mean to say that Gautier is particularly wrong. Whenever I look at it, it is intuitively plausible. It's just the spacing that is implausible. This was made 40 years ago. It was immediately striking, at least for those who are interested in the sociology of literature. It has been replicated almost never. Why? Because there are no criteria, except what Bourdieu knew. But, you know, and again, it's not that what he knew was wrong, but it's how does one replicate that? So we decided to try and make prestige and popularity measurable. There is a term which is important for our research. It's a very ugly word. It's operationalized. It means how do you, to operationalize a concept means turning a concept into a series of operations, sort of basically of mathematical instructions, that then a computer can count. So, how do we operationalize prestige and popularity? We chose two measures for each. In the case of popularity, you may recall that, let me take a step back. The historical sort of period is 1770, 1830. The reason for that is that this is a period for which we have excellent bibliographies of English novels. So basically, all English novels that have been published are there. Not only that, but Raynor and Darcy, who have done those bibliographies, have also sort of found and included in the bibliography the number of reprints and the number of translations into German and French, which is the near identical translations. We have used these two measures to measure popularity. Reprints is a very good proxy because just about all books at the time had the same print run, which was between 750 and 1,000 copies. So if they were reprinted five times, chances are they had sold five times more than a book which had never been. So these are the axis of popularity. The axis of prestige, there is a problem because it is questionable. William St. Clair is a scholar living today in a completely different field from ours, who has written a very huge and very incredibly rich work on England, English leaders in the period we are studying. And as he points out, and he's not the only one, he's just a very good authority, there was really hardly a notion of literary prestige for novels at the time. Poetry was a different matter, and so was drama. But for novels, there is no way to, or at least we have not found a way to count, to measure prestige. We have found ways of measuring prestige in the 20th century. Again, two ways. One is the Dictionary of National Biography. Sure, France has very much the same thing. And author by author, we count how many lines or words, I can't remember now, the DNB gives to every given author. And then the second source is not a national dictionary biography, it's the international scholarship, the publications of the modern language associations, 100 years, 1900, 2000. How many times the name of a given author appears in the title. One could do it slightly differently, but this is one way of doing things that is frequent in the United States. Okay, so we have now four measures, two for prestige and two for popularity. We are aware that the measures for popularity come from around 1800, the measures for prestige come from the 20th century. It's a problem. But it's I think a beginning to try and see what is going on. Finally, I will show you a chart which has, unlike Bourdieu, it has a metrics 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on the side. The metric we have used is called is what is usually called standard deviation. Standard deviation is a way of measuring how similar, self-similar or not, is a population. Say we are height. We calculate the average height in this room, it's 1 meter and 70 centimeters. But then we're not all 1 meter and 70 centimeters. One is 173, 165, 189, whatever. We take all these differences and basically average the difference and say that on average we are 3 centimeters distant from 170. That is the standard deviation. And then you have the average, and then you take all those between 167 and 173, one standard deviation on each side. That's, you know, one standard deviation distance. Then all those between 164 and 176 is two standard deviations. Usually, just about 95% of the population is within two standard deviations. So it is a good way to figure out how compact populations. So on the side, you will see the number of standard deviations that a given author is away from the mean in terms of popularity and of prestige. Okay, and finally, the first empirical results, and here it is. Prestige, popularity, unfortunately, this is not very big, I can tell you. So, and then the field is bisected. These are 30 degrees angle, which means that, say, every point along this line has twice as much prestige. This scores 12 on the sides of prestige and 6 on that of popularity. The opposite here, 12 on the side of popularity, so you can see. And then in the middle is the balanced field. Ideally, you could have a line bisecting the field, and those who line more or less along the line are equally popular and prestigious. It's, I think, a simple but effective way of looking at things. You probably cannot read the names, so let me just give you some indication. This character here is Walter Scott. And, you know, in a sense, see immediately how different this is from Bourdieu's map. I mean, how much more unbalanced the field is than it looks in his chart. This recovers the sense in which Walter Scott was unheard of, incredible phenomenon, for example. He's 22 standard deviations away from the mean in terms of popularity. And if anything, we here understate his success, because I told you, most novels have print runs of 1,000 copies. Waverly, his first novel, had a print run of 6,000, the second novel 8,000, the third novel 10,000, so he's even more on the line of this. On the left, this is good. We kept foreign authors because they were part of the British literary field. This is Goethe, this is Boston. And now, you know, the next step we took on this was, okay, what does an image like this suggest about the internal organization of the literary field? This is a little too large to get the sense. So the next image would go down to 5 and 5 on both axes. It's basically this field. This, incidentally, this is where the archive lies. So this first, this is where, this is the, you know, 95% of the population lies within 2 standard deviations. This is where they are. And actually, this first attempt, this first, I speak another 5 minutes or so about these charts, this really has only to do with the camera. Remember, our thought was, how can we make the camera measure? And something has become visible, but not the archive. So I will return to my initial question later. So let's go down to one level. And what you see here is, well, first of all, this group in the center. Defoe, Stern, Fielding, Richardson, Burney, Goldsmith, this is Smollett, Power, Lipton, Godwin, etc., etc. This is really the space of, indeed, the camera, what usually is considered the camera, which is the perfect balance, or as perfect a balance as one can imagine, of the two axes of popularity and history. The axis of popularity has a different group of writers. This is the area of the field, which is the area of genre. But not of one genre, of all genres. There is no way to be a popular novelist, at least in England, in those two generations. There is no way to be a popular writer unless you devote yourself to a genre. These are only one genre writers, basically. Some of them were very prolific, so Hooper not only wrote historical novels, but wrote also sea stories. But, you know, basically, Charles Smith, Anne Opie, you find all the genres of the age. The Gothic, a lot of names of that, the historical novel, the so-called Jacobin and anti-Jacobin novels, sentimental novels, the Vogue launched by Mackenzie, and novels for children, which were very rare, but was a very identifiable market niche, etc. So, what an area of the camera, an area of genre. This is the strangest part of all. This is the axis of prestige. And here, let me go back up. You find foreign authors, Goethe. We'll find others, I promise. But you also find a lot of writers who are not mostly novelists. Like Disraeli is a novelist, but he's also a politician. Johnson wrote a novel, but he was basically an essayist. Shelley wrote novels, but he was basically a poet. And if we go down into what Agatha Ben wrote novels, but she was mainly a journalist. John Russell wrote a novel, but was mainly, again, a politician. And then, as you get, Walpole wrote a very successful novel, but he was mostly something else. Then you find Rousseau, Cervant, etc., etc. So, this is as if the field seemed to, again, let me repeat it, in England at the time, seems to divide itself rather neatly, because if we keep going down, it's really the same type of phenomenon, seems to divide itself in these three main areas. Canon, genre, and this third area, the area of prestige. Something like I honestly still haven't found a good name for it. We haven't found a good name. We tend to call it the area of cultures. It's clearly not just knowledge. So one final conclusion on this first point. This is England at the turn of the 19th century. Bourdieu was writing on France in the third quarter of the 19th. Both charts, even though they're very different, could be right, or both could be wrong, obviously. That's not, ours is different from his, but that doesn't mean that it falsifies it. On one point, however, it suggests a different approach to high literature. You may remember for Bourdieu, the autonomous field current authors is the economic world reversed. What we are thinking, how does one end up in this middle position where popularity and prestige are both balanced? Usually, we suspect we are now running some checks between 1770 and 1830. Just about every author begins here with high popularity, and as time goes on, they lose popularity. If they're lucky, everybody loses popularity. No one becomes more popular over time. No one. Everyone loses popularity. The only difference is that some people lose popularity and simply end up here. Most people, almost all. A few in this process of losing popularity manage to get a lift in the direction of high prestige. Now, the interesting question, but this becomes a morphological question, and honestly, we haven't, I can show something, I'm not completely sure, but why do a couple of authors that, say, Maturin here and Clara Reeve, both authors of Gothic novels, Clara Reeve, you've never heard of. Maturin, you may have. He's the author of Men of the Moon. So, probably you've heard. So, in the process, in the course of time, Maturin, although he would have lost popularity, would also move up in the prestige. Why? What makes that difference? This is where the sociological approach ends and a morphological one begins. So far, there are hundreds of names of authors here, and I haven't said a single thing about what they actually write. From now on, I turn to morphology. Unfortunately, I do not turn to morphology from these charts. These are relatively recent results. So we turn to the morphology we were doing before we actually came up with this way of thinking about things. The two parts are not aligned, but I think the morphological results are independent of this, are potentially interesting, and we are now trying to cross them with these data. However, the first of these, as you can see, the interesting thing is that if you want to investigate the archive, this is not the right way to do it, because as you keep zooming in, it becomes more and more undistinguishable. Whereas the early charts, you could actually see, to me, it's three different fields. Someone could see something else, but clearly there were different sections. At this stage, it is very hard to intuit anything about those. All right. Remember, the question was, okay, what can the archive teach us that we do not know from the camera? Our first question, in this respect, we ask too many questions, and the first one is this. There is a common place about forgotten books. And the common place is that these books are forgotten because they are boring, repetitive, redundant, etc. So, is this common place true? This may tell us something about it, which we think we know, but maybe a way of actually knowing. But how does one measure redundancy? This is where one of our programmers, Mark Algie, Hewitt in this case, he came up with this idea. Let's measure redundancy by taking bindlines, because it's not easy to measure repetitiveness. I mean, you can have the feeling of being bored, but what exactly would this flow of words make you bored? So he said, let's take bindlines. Bindlines are two consecutive words. Bigrams R is one bigram, R2 is another bigram, two consecutive is another bigram, etc. All the bigrams of about 3,000 novels, I think we are conducting this experiment with, let's see how often bigrams repeat themselves in texts. When we ran this experiment, we were still working with the Chabot-Healy database. So we had an a priori definition of canonical texts and archival texts. And each of these texts appears as a blue or a red, blue the canon and red the archive dot on a scale of redundancy. And I'm sure you can at least see the color scheme is actually a rather striking result. Are forgotten books more redundant, i.e. less informative than canonical books? Yes. This is an incredible separation. For those of us who work in quantitative history, you seldom get a distinction which is as clear as this. This is now it's the same data reworked in a way that's more intuitive. This is the average redundancy for the archive and for the canon. This is the 25% above and below the medium, then this is the other two, 25%. As you can see, 25, 50, 75, 80%, perhaps more, of the archive is more redundant than 75% of the canon. It's really a hell of a differentiation. And then you can go into the images. This is the field that works. I think I made a mistake. This is the field that I was showing you. You take this part here, which is the early part, the first 30 years. It's Austen, Percy, this is Shelley, O.P., Austen, Hannah Moore, Shelley, Mary Grant of Austen, Mary Shelley, F. Mary Shelley, Austen, and so on. You just get a sense. These are the least redundant. The more informative, let me give it a cut. Let's say that the more, if you are more redundant, you are less informative, and vice versa. And the same happens if we look at novels. This is Pride and Prejudice, this is the Strozzi, and so on. Pride and Prejudice is one of the least repetitive novels in the entire corpus. Now, this is not a discovery, because we thought we knew that the archive was more redundant than the canon. But it is knowledge. We thought we knew, now we know. There is a problem. And I think the measurements are unquestionable, it's very strong, etc., etc. What consequences does that have for our knowledge at other levels? Okay, diagrams to people. And what does that mean, say, for stylistic analysis? And here it becomes very difficult, because in a novel, say, a novel 200,000 words has 200,000 bigrams. And how to measure the redundancy, I'll show you how the form that the data have. This is an enormously small portion of our data, and it's a list of 53 occurrences, at least 52, in that 52, is at 52. What do you do with this? What can one do with this? And we've been, trying to figure out ways and how should you come up with anything. For instance, at first we said, well, let's look for significant, potentially significant bigrams like happy, or the awful. But you know, the awful appears once in a novel, so it is completely irrelevant from the viewpoint of these measurements. So we haven't yet come up with a way of making these results significant for literary analysis of a higher order. Which, first of all, it's frustrating, and this is obvious. Second, it's actually interesting, because it's having discovered that there is a measurable feature in the text, which can be measured, whose measurement gives very strong results, and yet whose significance is unclear. This is, to me, one of the challenges. This is one has been one of the most interesting challenges I have found in this field. Finding something which sends such a clear signal, and which is of such difficult interpretation. But it is the type of challenge that I think we should be looking for in this new field. This is not a new result, but what is new is the feature through which we came to the result. Now, of course, if we will never figure out how to make this meaningful for the kind of discussion that we are having now, this would be magical. But it is still interesting that these things should happen. It is what I personally think should happen in a new field of research. That this shows you that the tools are more powerful than our concepts. But this is not a good reason to give up the tools, this is a good reason to try and make our concepts more. If you're thinking that now I'm going to tell you how our concepts became more powerful as a consequence of this, you're wrong, because as I said, we're not there yet. And this is the second part. This is the first morphological part. This is the second aspect of the morphological part. The type token ratio is a measurement used very often by corpus linguistics. It's very simple. It's basically a measure of linguistic diversity. I say, this is a very nice room. Six words. So six tokens. But also six types, because each word is different from the other. If I say, this is nice, a nice room. Six words, nice is repeated. So, in the first case, type token ratio was 6/6. 1. In the second, it's 5/6. 0.83 or whatever it is. It's a lower type token ratio, but it's greater than. If I say, thank you, thank you, thank you, still six tokens, but only two types. Type token ratio 0.3, so even lower. So type token ratio is a measure of linguistic diversity, and it's a measure that is often, though not universally, but often associated with higher literature and the canon. This is one of the great American critics writing about Wallace Stevens. One of the most important things is its vocabulary, collections of words, many of them uncommon. So yeah. Linguistic diversity, indeed. I have these words, I have no idea what they even mean. Now, remember, this is what we have found with the bigrams. This is the moment to say redundancy information. Well, some currents within information theory say that information and redundancy are really the two sides of the same thing. The less redundant a message is, the more informative it is, and vice versa. I think I'm not sure. I don't agree. It seems that when you measure redundancy, you're only measuring one thing. You can say that all that is not redundant is informative, but basically what you're saying is that all that is not redundant is not redundant. It's not an independent thought. However, linguistic diversity is an independent thought. Linguistic diversity has to do with the number of different words that get used in a given passage. And so we expected that this finding would be corroborated, maybe even increased, that the canon would score much, much higher than the archive on the temperament ratio measurement. And instead, as you can see, the canon scores lower. This was another sort of rather dramatic finding. Everything seemed to suggest that we should fight it. We double-checked it more than once, but it is like this. These are the 10 19th century novels with the highest type token ratio. I haven't read any of them. You probably haven't heard any of these authors. I've heard of this author here. Now I've read some parts of some of them, but still, these are the novels with the highest linguistic diversity in the English 19th century. Conversely, this is where the canonical author, the least redundant of all writers, is also actually one of the least diverse. The same is true for Dickens, and the same dramatically true for Eliot. Whose certain passage of a text by Eliot was the lowest in the whole corpus. And this is what, just to give you again a sense of the tools, how did we measure that token ratio? And this is again something that we need to get from corpus linguistics. It's 1,000 words, and as words start repeating themselves, Ryan added the little pound sign. I have turned it red. See, there is an and there, so when it repeats itself, there is a little pound sign, and stronger, etc., etc. So, this is the beginning of the passage, which is mostly black, because words haven't had time to repeat themselves. This is the end of the passage, where words are almost all. Have almost all already appeared in the text. The blue ones are Habax Legomena, and I also left, as you can see, you know, our program makes a mistake. For some reason, it decides that the negative word of verbs, it's a word, and even though it recurs all the time, it never repeats itself. So, you know, these things are not perfect. You need to be aware of what is not. Now, there is something strange. I don't know how many of you, probably not many of you know Adam Bede, but Adam Bede, an early novel by Eliot, is also the novel in which Eliot has a famous excursus. This is as close as any English novelist has come to having an explicit poetical realism. For what I know, though I may be wrong, the very term realism entered the aesthetic and the literary discussion in France in the 1840s as a consequence of a book on Dutch painting. And even though Eliot probably didn't know of that, you know, she hit on the same moment in art history to deliver a poetic of realism. A poetic of realism is always a poetic of detail, better of details, many. A poetic of realism has nothing to do with repetition. It should be a poetic of diversity. So, how is it possible that the same writer who is constructing a novel on the basis of these poetics of realism ends up having the least diverse section in the entire 19th century corpus? Well, the reason is that you can go to the section, you see here, you go to the section and read it to see what is happening that it's so repetitive. As you are seeing, you know, this is an approach in which you go back to the text and read. At times you are unsuccessful because bigrams you cannot do anything with. With this, maybe we'll be a little more successful. But the difference is that this is a reading that is always prescribed by the tools with which you are working. You may spend hours reading. I spent more time reading this passage than I probably ever have reading any passage in any novel. But the passage was chosen for me because of certain operationalization of certain concepts. So it is a very intense reading, which, however, has no longer any relationship with the, shall we call it, the natural reading process. The continuity between the reader and the critic is broken. Even when the critic reads very attentively, it does not read as a reader. It reads as a sort of a pathologist, something like that. The specimen and how to analyze. So what happens in that passage? Well, again, in this novel, there is a young woman who gets seduced, who has a baby. She abandons the baby to die, and the baby dies. And this is her confession of the passage. This is, it comes here. This is a long passage, and this is the moment in which she explains. And she says something, this is a beautiful passage. "And I made haste out of the wood, but I could hear it crying all the while. And when I got out into the fields, it was as if I was held fast. I couldn't go away. For all I wanted so deeply. And I sat against the haystack to watch if anybody would come. I was very hungry, and I only had a bit of bread left, but I couldn't go away." The sentences that are underlined seem to me to contain the solution to the question. She cannot go away, and she repeats it all the time on the days of the world, she cannot go away in the story, just as she cannot go away from that moment in the telling of the story. So what is happening here is not exactly the same thing, but it's very close to what Freud describes in the essay on repetition, reenactment, and working through is the English translation. It's the essay on getting stuck on past experience, on being trapped in past experience. In other words, why is this so repetitive? Because repetition is a powerful way of representing trauma and the impossibility of freeing oneself from trauma, from a traumatic experience. So, what this suggests, remember how I got to this, was a measure of linguistic diversity considered naively as a measure of linguistic virtuosity and therefore of quality. So it's surprising then to find so little diversity in Austin, Dickens, Eliot, etc., all very virtuoso writers. Now one understands why, because actually repetition can be put to an aesthetic end. It can be a very powerful, if sort of tricky, way of achieving an important aesthetic. But here you also then see something important. Basically, the same basic practice of repetition seems to mean two different things at two different scales of the text. Among backgrounds, it seems to sentence a writer to being forgotten. At the level of larger sentences, paragraphs, etc., etc., it seems to suggest that the writer can put it to extremely powerful use. Like an idea of the text that we are sort of slowly developing from different angles, in which different things happen at different scales. And at times, in this case, not just different, but opposite things seem to happen at different scales. Let's look at the opposite extreme. Enormously diverse text. This is the highest scoring segment in terms of target-open ratio, and the way in which this Edward Hawker, otherwise unknown author of a single novel, achieves this is a lot of hapax legomena here, but mostly a way of always joining adjective and noun, adjective and noun, refreshing, expansive sheath, noble tales, countless hope. Can't use a noun without adding an adjective. And even more so, this is from the same book, it's a description of Gibraltar, and as you can see, you look at this, and between nouns in red, and adjectives and participles in blue, they basically cover the entire text. It's amazing. This is but what does that mean? That there are so many nouns and adjectives. This is a very referential point. It has to do with the world out there. Another little paradox, and I don't want to exaggerate the value, but interesting discovery. We usually associate a referential poetics to aspects of 19th century realistic writing, but actually a bunch of completely unknown writers go much farther than any potential realist in that direction. See by comparison the same criteria, nouns and adjectives, in the passage in Arabic. Almost completely empty of nouns and adjectives. So it's really this polarity. This polarity, incidentally, is many polarities in one. It has to do with these grammatical features that I pointed out. It is also a polarity between character and narrative, and also between spoken and written. So, what can the archive teach us? But in this case, the answer would be, well, it teaches us that actually many, most, who knows, of these forgotten authors, certainly many, were forgotten because they tended towards a more written style than the Austens and Eliots and Lincolns. It's as if the very fact a more written, potentially more referential, certainly a more varied style, or terms that we tend to associate with the writing of good novels seem to be far more present in those cases. Sort of summary statistics, so type-open ratio correlates usually positively with the frequency of nouns, of adjectives, of word length. Again, this is the written quality. That description of Gibraltar, look at how many words of Latin origin are there in this passage, and I don't think I even taught them all. This is abnormally high for an English text. But again, words of Latin origin are words that usually have to do with the written register and with the knowledge of the referential. So it are all things that hold themselves together. Negative correlation, type-token ratio correlates negatively with the frequency of words. You have to choose. If you fill a passage with nouns, adjectives, and participles, there is simply no room for verbs. And you know that same Gibraltar passage, there are, I think, 6 or 7 inflected verbs, just you know, very few in the whole passage. Instead, look at this. This was the Aramid passage, this is a passage. But again, this is a little strange because we tend to think that the forgotten 19th century archive would be very high in all markers of narrativity. So it's, you know, things that happen all the time. Many more things seem to happen in the writing of Eliot than in the final and unfortunately only chart of that kind. Here I return to those dots I showed at the beginning and show how type-token ratio correlates negatively So a high type-token ratio is usually bad for the popularity of writers. Look at this rectangle up here, very high type-token ratio, only three writers with a standard deviation of two or above in terms of popularity. Look at this at the bottom, bishop vice versa, where there are a bunch of popular writers and very few blue dots from the archive. As popularity, as type operation goes down, popularity and even prestige, I think we haven't had time to make those terms, becomes lower. Final point on this chart and on the whole thing. I began with Bourdieu's or Bourdieu-like remake of the Bourdieu chart, completely sociological measures. Totally external to what is in the text. It's just how many times it's reprinted, how often it's quoted in the PMLA, etc. Then I turn to things that are in the text, kind of ratio, redundancy, etc. This is the first chart in which we try to put together a sociological measurement and a morphological one. It's not much, I'm aware of that, it's the beginning. But you see that once you can measure the inside of the text and the outside of the text, what becomes, if not possible, at least imaginable, it's really a morphological sociology. A systematic combination, which was completely absent in Bourdieu. Bourdieu could have cared less about what was in the text. And, you know, that's fine, it's an approach like any other. But clearly, if we can come up with ways of combining sociological measures and morphological features, that will realize, what has been for a long time a dream of aesthetic theory, of combining these two possibilities. As the first slide said, this is work in progress, and the progress ends here. Centuries, three or four times, five times that. At the end of the centuries, 1,000 and more per year. So, you know, a bibliography that misses it, it's very easy for a bibliography to have, you know, thousands of novels and still miss out of the field. So we cannot replicate the same charts with that distribution at the beginning. You can still do the study of individual authors that have been well studied, but you cannot study the literary field. So you cannot do that. You can definitely do a kind of grammatical analysis that that we've conducted with that documentation of the bygones, because there, well, you have a corpus, whatever it is, you make no claims that it's the entire literary field, but you can definitely analyze that. And the corpus, I mean, indeed, it would be lovely, and it's likely to happen that we would do it with a French, or we, or someone else, we would do it with a comparable French corpus and see what the similarities or not are.
Est-ce que vous avez tenté d'autres types de corrélations, par exemple avec le nombre de personnages, avec la diversité des personnages, les noms propres? Est-ce que ça peut être envisagé? Et autre type de corrélation possible avec la longueur des textes même?
No, this is as the same is normalized for the length of the text. So, like for instance, the type-token ratio, if you say 10 words, you can still have a type-token ratio of 100%. If you say 1,000 words, it's impossible to make a speech. So type-token ratio, the longer a text goes, the lower it gets. But there are ways of averaging for that, and we've used them. So these results are independent of length. We haven't done correlations with proper names, or say with the position in within the novel. When user can, I assume that since most passages with a very low type-token ratio, like the Adam Beat, like the Elliot one, tend to be oral, tend to be confessions of dramatic episodes, they're actually too infanticized and a kidnapping of a child, one of the three highest scoring in the 19th century in England. They have to occur towards the end of the years. They cannot occur early. I mean, the trauma must be significant, must have happened in the classic sense. We have done something like that for other things, but you know, here, for me, here the real question is how we manage to understand what those scam bygones mean. Because it's a fantastic find that we can't, that we cannot understand. We know it, but we don't understand. I think it's fantastic. I think that as a situation, it's a situation for which we are completely unprepared. It's true, it's definitely true, but for me, So that's where we are trying to, but it clearly has to be understood, broadly speaking, mathematically. Because with the concepts of literary theory, we try to make that it just doesn't. One has to come up with some equation, which makes sense then for us as literary theorists, but to figure out how to move those things. We use proper names for other studies. I mean, you just don't do everything every time, because otherwise, it's okay.
You studied the linguistic difference between the archive and the canon. You used mainly morphological features, lexical features, bigrams, type tokens. Did you explore to use syntactic features, more deep syntactic features, like syntactic complexity, readability? Maybe these features have something to do in work of different
Yeah, no, we haven't done that. There are parsers that can take a corpus and for each sentence tell you how many clauses it has, which is, you know, a good approximation of syntactic complexity. And we haven't done it. And as you were saying, there are other measurements that one could take of this. At this point, it seems to me that the most urgent thing is solving what we have found, what we don't understand, and finding ways of crossing the new results that we have found on the basis of Hungarian prestige with these initial measures. And then what goes on? I mean, it's we haven't done it. This is every study must have its limits, as you know, and these are the limits of this one.
Une question sur les critères de popularité et de prestige.
Yeah.
Pour la popularité, vous avez des données quantitatives de l'accumulation. Pour le prestige, finalement, vous étudiez le prestige au XXe siècle. Et si on prenait la critique contemporaine au XIXe siècle, on aurait une vue tout à fait différente. Donc ce prestige, il varie dans l'histoire littéraire. Est-ce que, alors, vous avez trouvé un moyen de quantifier, mais. Est-ce que ça biaise pas quand même la vision qu'on a?
Well, the trouble is that there is very little contemporary criticism of the, you know, prestige-inducing type. So, as we were talking this morning, we are going to now extract a corpus of 19th century reviews of novels that are published in journals, etc., and use those. Whether those reviews are a sign of prestige in the same way that, say, an article in a scholarly journal or the Dictionary of National Biography is questionable. Very often they were just part of the commercial circuit, and but still it would be interesting to have another measure which lies somewhere in the middle between between the two, and it's from the age rather than from the sentence. No question. But, you know, the indicators of prestige that we have now are relatively recent. At least for novels, at least for novels, if you study novels. We've tried to come up, you know, those named after or, you know, mentioned, but they're too erratic. It's very hard to create a quantitative series with that. And too late, also.
C'est le problème, c'est le décalage temporel, c'est qu'on mesure le prestige à l'instant T pour nous, et non pas quel était le prestige dans le champ littéraire de l'époque.
Yeah. No, I agree, but it's hard to measure. In a sense, if you think about it, Bourdieu's chart, why is it, you know, from the 50s, 1850s, 1860s? Because the precondition of the chart is that there is now an autonomous concept of literary prestige, independent of social success. And France was in the avant-garde in this respect, as we all know. And so, in Britain, you don't find it till the 1890s, so the very end of the century. Or at least not find it enough for it. But that seems to be the problem.
Prestige, il est assez raisonnable de considérer le prestige tardif, le prestige qui dure, pas seulement le prestige à l'instant. Donc il me semble que la popularité est plutôt une chose immédiate et la canonisation nécessairement c'est quelque chose qu'on mesure plus tard. Avoir du prestige immédiatement, beaucoup de compte rendu, ça ne veut pas dire avoir été canonisé.
So we did not do it because we could not do it. And should not do it.
Et aussi des sociétés deux axes sont extraordinairement intéressants. Mais bon, c'est la corrélation en fait, entre l'idée de prestige et un phénomène strictement esthétique qui, à mon avis, strictement esthétique, que tu vas mesurer par le pensée subjective en particulier, alors là c'est tout à fait convaincant. Par contre, la question de la popularité, je ne suis pas, vu de l'extérieur, je ne sais pas qu'elle relève publiquement peut-être le phénomène en pensée subjective. Ça va connaître le phénomène éditorial, ça je suis tout à fait d'accord, mais il y a peut-être d'autres éléments que les éléments morpho-syntaxiques. Alors, il est vrai que bon, mon schéma montre bien que les deux sont, je pense qu'il y a que la popularité en termes éditoriales au départ, retour, un certain nombre de traits d'écriture qui sont caractéristiques de ce type de roman. Bon, on aboutit tout de même, étant donné à ça, à une question que ce matin, on avait parlé de ce qui était attendu, de ce qui était surprenant. Alors, je vous demanderai, au fond, est-ce que tu attendais ce résultat ou est-ce que tu as été quelque part surpris par ce résultat? Donc, il y a des auteurs qui, par exemple, la position de certains auteurs, de certains romanciers, te surprennent dans le graphe.
So, I was very surprised by the discontinuity between Redondo de Cid and Les Cantos. I think that's generally strange. So that remains as something, it's generally strange and it suggests an idea of text as a complicated mechanism. Not that we didn't know that it was complicated. Okay, but now we have found another level of complication, which I guess I was not surprised by the when one looks at those initial charts, if I can go quickly back up to those. I was not surprised by the middle period. I was not surprised by the group in the middle, maybe the next one is better. Because I've always thought that what is called canon is always, you know, has to have started as something popular. So I was not surprised by that. I did not expect to find genre writers so well distinguished in one part of the field, and I was very surprised, but there again, we don't have a concept yet, by the fact that so many of the prestigious writers are not really writers. They are musicians, as you go down, they are musicians, they are painters, they are this and that. So, that in a sense, these people here, like Russell, Walpole, and then there are other minor, you know, 18th century English figures that I don't know, I imagine you don't know either, but they are important for a national. But obviously, they have, you know, at least measured on those measures of prestige, they're as prestigious as before or richer Sorosler. But clearly, there's a profound difference. So, what I find fascinating about those charts, not yet elaborated, is that canonical libraries seem to be authors that originate in a genre, but manage to have the genre speak to the culture as well. Whereas genre writers can be very good in their niche, but it's just their niche. And then this other group can be very prestigious, but they have no real presence on the literary market. That middle position. So, was I surprised? By parts of this graph, not by the whole thing. But I was very happy because I always thought that Bourdieu's thing was unrealistic, and it is unrealistic. That was, well, was, I mean, the fact that I've been thinking about it for decades and I finally managed to find a way to measure it shows up the respect I have for that way of approaching things. But reality, the nice thing about this is, reality is always in this. It's always in this. And the digital demand is one of their virtues is that even though, you know, we have those two lines, and I say, well, the literary field can be divided into three sections, and okay, I see that, I hope I've more or less persuaded you, but all the evidence that I have found is there, and someone can say, you're crazy, there is really only one section here, and it's, you know, you have to explain it otherwise. So the difference between the explanation of this study and the explanations, even the great explanations of literary history, is that in this case, the inopportune empirical evidence does not disappear. I find that fascinating. I think it's a good thing for the spirit, because it makes us stop.
Ça s'enchaîne dans la même revenir sur la question des critères et surtout celui de la traduction. Si j'ai bien suivi, la traduction, le nombre de traductions est rangé dans la catégorie des critères de popularité. Et je pense que c'est aussi un des critères de prestige. Dans certains cas, en tout cas, la traduction peut être le vecteur de canonisation d'un auteur. C'est le cas surtout
du 20e
siècle, mais...
I don't know.
Cervantes... Non, Pardon, mais c'est un ancien.
Yeah, yeah. Translations are on this axis here. And, well, you know, this is something I have a little bit studied in the past as well. And you can look at translations in two ways. It's the power of, in this case, English literature, just boom, this Walter Scott happens and ends up, or other cultures that want to have this. I think, you know, the first way of seeing the impact of a culture on other cultures is stronger. However, one thing that we still have to, because, you know, one is stupid. I mean, we should have, there is no reason we should have four measures and then put together the two prestige and the two popularity measures. We should have four different charts, a Dictionary of National Biography and reprints, Dictionary of National Biographies and translations, etc., etc. It's already abstract what we've done. Then we've abstracted the abstraction. But now I have to explain to my team that we have to redo the whole thing.
I'm postponing the moment in which I will.
So you can see for which of those authors translations matter or not. And that is a way also of answering your question. If it turns out that for Austen or Scott or Cooper they matter, but for Helen and Reed herself, then probably your ideas is not.
Do you think it would be possible to correlate prestige and popularity with the complexity of the blocks? I mean, we often think that simple blocks are in the canon and very complicated blocks in popularity.
Hey, but how do you measure blocks? But the complications is in the number of characters is only start the number of bifurcations. I mean, go and tell the computer how to recognize the bifurcation. I would love. I mean, this is in a sense, you know, I've never been a stylistic critic. I have become, I will not say stylistic, but I've started to look at grammar, etc., because we cannot look at plot. Then you can count words, you can count clauses, you can count syntax, you can measure them. But measuring plot, I mean, there have been some attempts, but they have been very, very
intellectual knowledge in my life. So the day we can measure cloth. Incidentally, even counting characters is not that easy. Counting characters is relatively easy, the number of properties. It's a decent approximation. And anyway, it's a small number, and so you can let it be like that. But when characters do something in novels, novelists have a very bad habit of using pronouns instead of characters. And once pronouns enter the scene, it becomes extremely hard to follow. You can see this is, and we're just at the beginning of the competitions. So,
une lecture humaine peut se servir de l'instruction. On a une lecture humaine d'abord, et après une instruction donnée à un compétiteur.
Formalize it and we do it. You send us the formula and we give you the results. Promise.
Ce qui me semblait le plus surprenant, c'est que en définitive, ce soit l'effet stylistique de dépouillement et de simplicité, voire d'oralité, qui font que le roman le plus prestigieux, selon toi, c'est celui qui est le plus dépouillé. Or, c'est vrai que c'est une esthétique, on va dire, plutôt modernisante, en courant du 19e siècle, c'est aussi très intéressant. Parce que ça fait apparaître qu'en définitive, le style, au contraire, qui fonctionnait à l'édition du coup, adjectif, nom, etc., de manière un peu lancinante, est déjà un fait de style utilisé. Et une sorte de jugement qui renverrait d'ailleurs une forme de copyright. Et ce que tu semblais dire, c'est que plus le style est léché déjà dans cette période, plus au fond l'ouvrage est populaire et plus il est appelé à l'oubli, à disparaître. Et ça, c'est un élément, en tout cas, bon, c'est un élément qui apparaissait très bien et qui, en même temps, fait qu'on n'est pas seulement dans le morceau d'un taxi, mais on est déjà dans le champ de
ce qui est. There is also, speaking of, you know, texts as complicated mechanisms, there is also an asymmetry between high type token ratio and low type token ratio. High type token ratio, you know, a lot of adjectives and nouns. You can imagine using fewer adjectives and fewer adjectives and fewer nouns. You know, it's truly a quantitative measure. After all, adjectives are like little measurements of the noun, right? You know, a house, and then you specify. It's not a measurement, but it's a specification. Okay. You can imagine that as a quantity. You take the George Eliot passage. You can't repeat a little less and less and less. No, that is just like a qualitative event that happens. So, whereas one is a generally quantitative. The other is quantifiable, but it's discontinuous. I mean, it's more like an extreme case that has to be in that way. Whereas Mr. Hawker has pages in which he's a little less obsessive with his So there is something there that I haven't yet completely figured out, but clearly they're not the opposite of each other. They're not simply. It's not a sliding scale.
Il y a quelque chose de plus important. Je pense que c'est possible, comme un des gars, les différences que Malik a fait sur le temps de l'heure. C'est-à-dire, le présent, le passé, l'imparfait, et donc, le roman du début du 19e
a une présence du commentaire qui est plus grand dans le moment.
Si, si, it is definitely possible. Yeah, it's one of the many things we haven't done. On verbal tenses, there is a further reason. It's not just human limits that we haven't done. But there are programs that recognize tenses. They're not very good. Whereas, you know, when they have to recognize, say, parts of speeches, adjectives, nouns, adverbs, you know, their level of recognition can be 90, 95, 98%. With verbs, it's often very low. It's still better than chance, and so for linguists it's okay, but for the, if you want to do the careful analysis, it's a little more tricky. Moreover, in English, verb, especially in the present form, and noun, very often are morphologically impossible to distinguish. Drink can be a drink or the act of drinking, and so on for many, many things. So that is an added complication. So that's specifically English. So we, it's been, in the past, whenever we've used verbs, there has always been a statistical unreliability. Yes.
Une question sur le type de recherche. Là, vous mettez ensemble de 1770 à 1830, donc un seul gros corpus. Est-ce que ce serait intéressant et un projet plus possible au sein de ce corpus de voir les évolutions décennie par décennie dans la redondance?
We're doing
dans...
that. We're doing that. Exactly that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. At the beginning, we took the whole thing because we wanted to have an image. Now we're doing because that. Of course, that will not change the results for prestige because they come from, but it will change these results here because popularity and, you know, what we expect is that all authors will move, as I was saying, back in this direction and then new authors will start there and on that, actually, it would be interesting because we can then compare the half-length studies of Hollywood box office hits. And you know, of well, as you can imagine, how week by week how much money they make, and so there are already patterns that will occur that that text follow, and usually there is only really two curves: you start popular and decline, or you start that no one knows you, become popular and then decline. But there is no bimodal thing. There is no. Basically, there are these two documents. So, but that's exactly what we're doing. It's too small. 60 years is too small. And I don't know. I don't know whether even in France there is a bibliography which is complete and reliable for any period. Like this, I know, you can see. And.
Encore te remercier, hein, et sur cette séance séminaire.